For the most part, mass-produced clothing is produced offshore, but it's coming back. Made in America is in great demand, and we're seeing a lot of factories being rebuilt, actually with investments from China and India. Nike, I think, is building a big robot factory in Arizona. So we're seeing a big resurgence in producing goods back in America, which I think is fabulous. So I think there's some pretty healthy manufacturing in Miami too, from what I remember. So retailers and buyers are buying closer to the selling time. It helps them. So if the weather's bad and they're buying stuff for summer, it gives them a chance not to overextend. They're buying, as I say, smaller quantities. Okay, software. Obviously will help you. There are softwares out there, and actually on my cost sheet on this is in a dynamic format, so it's an Excel. Once you start adding in a cost sheet in the right way, that means then you can go forward and all your other cost sheets will be in the same format and formula. So in conclusion, stay focused on your niche, control all your costs, and constantly take time to monitor your business. Listen to your customers' needs and management team. Find the right team who understands the apparel business today, even if you have to pay more to get the right people. It will pay off in the run. Another thing you need to make sure of, making sure that whoever you find to help you, a consultant, some kind of maybe they're doing sample making or production, check them out, check the credentials. It's so important you know who you're working with. Find out who they work with. Ask, get referrals, check them out. As I told the story yesterday, a girl lost 54,000 producing goods, sampling, and they were all unusable. So make sure you know who you're working with, key. It's in this business, your journey is about networking. Okay, so you need a good CFO to track your internal. If you're just a designer and you're not training your brain to think business-wise, it's a big mistake. Don't get caught up in creating stuff, because if you feel like you have to create stuff and you're not interested in pricing, put it in an art show. You're going into business. You need to be aware that you want to make money at the end of the day, hopefully, right? Okay, so think ahead. Due to the many variables in our global economy, current costs may need to be revised. The revision will always be upwards. Deciding to produce offshore will need a plan to travel. Keep informed firsthand, not secondhand, when planning your production. I really do advise that you go and see, if you decide to go offshore, where they're being produced, inspect the factories, visit with them. Again, it's relationships. Building those relationships with offshore manufacturers. Amazing factories in China. I've had some incredible experiences working in China, and I have to say they've got some amazing factories for you to visit. So remember, it's not only about creating beautiful clothes, it's about running a profitable business. So if you need more information, I will be at the front desk. You can look at my books, my forms, my DVDs, and my other books, and they're on sale this week. And if you get the whole package, then I'll give you 20 minutes consultation, and we can do that anytime. So thank you, everybody. That's a lot to take in at 10:30 in the morning on a Wednesday morning. All right, well, we'll give you a test at the end of the day, okay? All right, nice to meet you all. I hope we'll see you soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Frances. Again, she's gonna be at the matchmaking booth, which is just past the main entrance. So if you had some more questions for her, that's where she'll be all day. So, thanks. Okay. going to get started with our next speaker. This is about East Africa and the value chain proposition and the sourcing and how East Africa is becoming a sourcing destination. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce Andres Saldias. He is the East he's the Apparel Trade Linkages Specialist for East Africa Trade and Investment Hub. Andres?
Thank you so much. My name is Andres Saldias, and I represent the East Africa Trade and Investment Hub. Our main office is based in Nairobi, Kenya, and this is a United States Agency for International Development project that is intended to promote East African factories to export to the United States under the duty-free status treatment. Basically, what this entails is that whenever you are importing garments to the U.S., you gotta pay import duties between 16 and 33% on the cost of the garment. Due to this AGOA called status, if you import from East African companies, you will pay no duty. That means a zero import duty. Itself, that's already an advantage with other countries, you know, especially Asian countries that even though they have a very large textile history, whenever they get into the U.S., they have to pay that duty. So that puts them in a disadvantaged situation because they will be 16 to 33% more in their final price. A reason that why the USA provides this zero import duty is because they want to create labor positions to underdeveloped countries like East Africa. Basically, the countries that we support in East Africa are Kenya, Tanzania, Ethiopia, Madagascar, Mauritius, Uganda, and Rwanda. And today I will be talking to you about how those countries have been developing the textile and apparel industry. I'm going to be sharing my findings on how I found those factories, because I was there in March visiting over 25 factories, which amazingly they are already with major working with major buyers in the United States. So this is called the value apparel value chain proposition, and again, this is based on what were my findings while I was in East Africa. Basically, I want you to understand that the purpose of my presentation today is to motivate potential buyers to understand how the factories work in East Africa as an option to source your fashion, your trends, your business. And if you were to ask what are the main concepts of what Africa has to offer, I would go into what's called the value chain between the raw materials, the technology, the production know-how, buyer trust, and vendor compliance. Those are the key factors that a buyer would like to understand before trusting their business into a new vendor in East Africa. So I'm going to go and show you, and I think this is the best way as we're talking about business, show you some pictures that I took myself when I was in these factories. So you can see from my own personal experience, how did I found these factories. I've been working in 29 countries in the apparel business during my career, and I visited over 300 factories. So when I was in East Africa, I was quite shocked and surprised to find the value chain integration, which starts again on the raw materials. This is me in a factory in Tanzania called A to Z, where they produce their own fiber. So they are already harvesting and producing cotton fiber, which is mid-size cotton. It's gonna go to counts of 20 singles, 30 singles, 40 singles, very nice quality, very stable production. And they're producing, of course, the spinning And the weaving and the knitting in factories called FN Denim, Sokota. Coincidentally, one of the factories that I visited, FN Denim, is in our booths. They are one of the larger producers of denim garments, and they are completely vertically operated, and they have really great capability, especially on the finishing of the garment that I will be discussing later. So as you can see, the raw materials is already in East Africa. The next component in the value chain from the buyer's perspective is, okay, how are they going to process those materials? Can they comply with the standards, you know, the ASTM standards, meaning on the NEPs, on the twisting, on the dead cotton contamination, and so on and so forth. And that's related to technology, how you're going to process your raw material to transform those materials into fabrics. And as you can see here, they have a wonderful capability. This is an auto stripe machine that can do up to three colors, auto stripe, vertical or horizontal lines of fabric, very well maintained, very isolated, good moisture, all it requires to produce a good piece of fabric industrially. This is another piece of equipment, really nice. You know, this is about $500,000 automatic colors kitchen that's going to be supplying the dyes automatically as per the approved lab dips from the buyers. So that means that they can reproduce any color that you will require. They'll send you a lab dip with three variations that you can really go into any computer, any spectrophotometer to confirm and validate that the color they are duplicating is exactly the color that your trends, your fashion, your design team is requiring for mass production. Again, this is me in the factory. This is the Slaforce coning machines, the very high advanced piece of technology made in Germany. So all this technology is providing a good quality raw material, which is basic in this industry. You can see here an automatic, fully automatic feeder for cutting. This is robotized with laser cutters. These are, you can find, of course, in Asia, in any large facility, because that's going to ensure that your cutting of your goods is under specs and they have no tolerances, basically, because it's the machine cutting instead of the human hand. And they have plenty of those working with electric technology, Gerber pattern systems, so they are up to date on everything that's related to the product design all the way through the finish of the garment. Here's another piece of equipment for knits. There are stall machines there for flat knits, you know, and they can go all the gauges from 14 to 24. This factory also is exhibiting in the show. They brought a very good offer to the show. And again, these factories are already working with major US large brands, like in this case, this factory is already producing for Calvin Klein, for example, which is a large US and very reputable firm in the country. This is Hella, another huge manufacturing company, about 3,000 workers, very organized sewing lines, very efficient production. They are reaching about 80% efficiency. They are working already for major buyers like PVH with the brands Tommy Hilfiger, Calvin Klein. So these companies already are in East Africa because they are seeing the value chain they can get from that region. And right here you can see the Calvin Klein production line. You can see how the fabric is coming in from the knitting machines. And just want to show you what I've seen. Again, all these pictures I took myself. These are not internet pictures. I was there a couple months ago inspecting these factories. This is a picture of FN Denim. Again, they are in the exhibiting booth. I haven't seen this much in this technology in many countries. Probably a couple in Asia, they have this technology. This is a laser sand technology for the jeans industry. This is highly oriented to fashion, to product development, because as you know, in denim, the wash is the most important thing because it's going to give the appearance. Everybody can do a denim in the world, but not all companies in the world can do mass production development of different washes and finishes like stone wash, sand wash. So what they ensure is duplication, 100% accuracy, because the sanding is not made by hand, it's made by a laser machine, which gives us the production items in mass production. You can see another nice flow of another factory. You can see the sewing lines. They are under vendor compliance. They are RAP certified, as you were seeing yesterday. They can produce under all the US requirements of safety, industrial hygiene. The workers are treated with respect, with highly ethics, and that's really something to consider when you are sourcing. This is another company that you can see the same sanding is being done by hand here. See how many workers are doing sanding machine? But here you can do in a machine, which is much faster and accurate. Production systems, like this one, the line is providing 696 garments. The quantity already at the finishing line, 998. Defective pieces, 0%. Defect rate, 0%. So this factory is really running well. They can do acceptance quality level, which is the standard in the industry, from 1 to 2.5, which are the most rigorous requirements from buyers that are really highly oriented in quality. That means basically from a lot of 5,000 units, the AQL number one is going to require to inspect 120 garments, and out of the 120 garments, this only allowed one or two minor defects. If they find two defects in those 120 units, the whole 5,000 units need to be re-inspected. That's the standard. That's how the major brands like Ralph Lauren, Tommy Hilfiger, Guess, J. Crew, Donna Karan, they apply to their production in whatever they are producing. And these factories already have the system, and they are not only manual, but they are also electronically programmed. So they have pretty good technology on handling the quality, because you know, it's one thing is to handle a couple hundred units, but if you are doing 10 million garments a year, then you need these kind of systems to ensure that the 10 million garments are going to come with great quality to the market. And that brings to the next item, which is buyer's trust. This is probably something very important to say in this show. Not everybody understands or knows that East Africa is an option to the apparel industry in the US market. They are coming as a great, I call them, you know, the great diamond growing, because it's becoming an option to traditional Asian Central American providers, because as you know, the labor cost in Asia is increasing rapidly, while in East Africa you still have that factor. An employee in Africa, a good skilled worker sewer, is making between $65 to $120 per month, right? While in other parts of the country of the world, like Asia, that range is about the $500 per month. So that there you have a significant difference on your costing sheet that the previous speaker was explaining. On top of the zero import duty, then that opens the eye to any buyer, any potential brand that's going to say, hey, you know, I better take a look on what's going on in Africa. And that's what has been happening in the last few years. And already firms like I mentioned, Calvin Klein, they're making their products in Kenya. Here you see the Children's Place, another very large operations. You have Tommy Hilfiger here. You have Nautica already working in East Africa. So the presence of US buyers is rapidly growing because of the offer on the value chain proposition that I'm explaining today. Here you can see also Walmart. You know, Walmart is the largest chain in the US, and they are already in East Africa, as well as Kohl's. Again, these are pictures that I took personally while I was in Africa. Kohl's is very strong in Kenya. Gloria Vanderbilt as well. So I just want to show you how this value chain proposition is already in the works, already happening in the country. And that's related to how well the factories can adjust and adapt to what your products are, needs are. And that's basically on the product development side. I've seen this great designing capabilities, and as you can see, this is a software to design any kind of patterns and print the fabric. Whatever is the design, the colors, they'll have the design. This is just a sample room of designers doing 24/7 only designs to provide the market the most important factor for you guys, which are the buyers, which is the fabric development, samples, structures, colors, differentiation on the prints. That's going to go then into mass production. This is a sample room, very nicely displayed on the jeans and the jackets. Again, this picture is FM Deming. They are exhibiting here at the show. They are by the booth at the main, right walking distance from the main entrance. That is me doing an inspection. As I mentioned, they have acceptance quality level number one, which is very, very demanding. Not all factories, not all buyers do AQL1. Typically they do 2.5, some of them do 4. The difference is on AQL1, you are much more strict. In other words, you don't allow more defects than a number 4 would do. There are even factories working with Japan, they don't work with AQL. They do 100% inspection with their own auditors that are in-house, working in a separate area, making sure that 100% of the garments before they are shipped to Japan are going to be fixed or properly managed it at the factory. And the last item, vendor compliance. This is probably the most important issue here, because as Project USAID Project, we want to make sure that these factories are enhancing the workers' labor condition by treating them ethically. And I've seen this in all factories. This is Socotra, Madagascar, an amazing compound that, as you can see, they are providing even soccer field, tennis courts, gymnasiums. They have their own school where they are training not only the sewers, but also the middle management. And that's very important to understand, that the middle management is a key factor for the factories, because they are the ones who are doing the audits, the inspection, the billing, the logistics, the export documentation, the import documentation, and so on and so forth. And so they are being trained by the upper management so they can occupy those positions. This is Ethiopia, and as you can see, there are some thousands of workers going to the factories here, and this is the line of buses because they provide transportation. They are mass production facilities. They are located, this is an area called Hawassa, which is an industrial park that the government is providing to any investors. And actually, many Chinese firms, large apparel textile industry from China, from Sri Lanka, from Bangladesh, are already investing and implementing factories in Hawassa and moving their production from Asia to Ethiopia, taking the advantages of the labor and the duty-free status, in addition to the logistics and the shipments and so on and so forth. So as you can see, this is also another good example of vendor compliance. People is being fed, thousands of workers living out of the industry, and this is the concept of the apparel industry from the other side of the coin. For the country means labor. Instead of people being at the streets without an income, that can take care of their families, the apparel textile industry traditionally provides those labor positions massively so they can have an income, a serious and dignified income, so they can support their families. And that's the intent of our USAID supported project, to create more labor conditions and labor positions. And as you can see, we make sure they are there. This is another vendor compliance. This is like in Kenya, for example. This is a canteen, a dining room. But what brought to my attention is the pictures of the Kenyan racers here in the dining room, and they are encouraging them. You know, we are winners. Kenya is a winner company. So when you are dining and eating in this room, you are getting inspired by the winners of Kenya, number one racers in the world. So that's the kind of messages they are providing to the people and the workers to pull up the country entirely. This is another thing that I really like from that shows good management. This is a board that is going to show, is going to ask every one of the factory what are the new ideas, how to implement the ideas, what is the progress of the ideas and completion of those ideas. And that comes from the workers. So they have like a, you know, suggestion box that they will put the, whatever they think is bothering them, how can they improve their processes and flow. And this shows great management skills of the HR departments that are treating the employees as they are. They don't call them employees, which is another great example. We should learn this in America. They call them team members. They are not workers. They are called team members. I wish everybody in our companies in the US would say, you know, we're team members all, rather than employees. You can see here places they can keep their babies, you know, in good daycares while they are working. And all this is paid by the company, you know. So they respect the women there. There's one company in that was really shocked that they have a special sample and a special production area, which is a large big building, actually about 1,600 workers, they are all women, and they are in condition, in pregnancy condition. So they will split the ladies from 0 to 9 weeks of pregnancy, doing, you know, probably harder work. The women from 9 weeks and up, they will do light duties in the factory, and the ones that are about to deliver, they just work few hours and they deliver. So they have a special production flow for these ladies, respecting their condition and their family situation, which is amazing. I haven't seen that in other countries in the world. And again, I work in the apparel industry in 29 countries, and I was quite shocked to see. And not only that, but they provide the medication and the doctors and all that's required before they are due on the pregnancy. So basically, wrapping up, this is the apparel value chain precision, proposition in East Africa. We have the IGOA status, zero import duty, 16% to 33% no cost to the importer here, the buyer, the license, the brand. This is a real alternative to Asia and other competitors. It's becoming already in the market. They do understand the concept of collaborative sourcing. This is probably the most important factor in this industry, because that means they will develop the brand, they will develop the designs, the samples with you, and be part of your team. They have pretty competitive lead times, between 6 to 12 weeks. They have quick response programs with great fabrics at 4 weeks. Transportation from East Africa to the nearest port in the US between anywhere to 18 to 41 days, depending on where. They have very good response time, so they can accommodate to your needs, to the fashion and the seasons. They have competitive pricing, not only skilled labor related. And so this is not just because they have low labor income in these countries, but they have other factors that will make the garment competitive, like the fabric supply, basically, because that's 60% of the cost, and you can source the fabric in Africa. Productivity, as I show you in the pictures, I've seen great productivity. The lowest production I've seen was 65%, which is not bad for the industry, but I've seen also 85% productivity, which is pretty much on the better side of standard. Just in time, they do understand how important it is to get the goods into the market whenever the buyer is in need. This is the most important thing in this industry. The apparel industry is not about products only. It's about service. The one who understand that, the factories who understand that, they understand that this is the kind of service and the product and the flow they need. Service, service, service. It's not only about products. It's about how you are going to accommodate your client. That is the value chain proposition for East Africa into the market. The apparel business is not only about product, it's about service to the client, so they can trust their business to a country and factory, and East Africa has what it takes. As you can see, this is already a reality. If you see the stats from the imports into the United States for the last 5 years, they are in a continuous growth, all the way to $720 million already being imported into the U.S. By producing East Africa. And as you can see, the trend is positive. And in this trend, this is new buyers into the country, new investors into the country, newer factories into the countries in East Africa, and it's showing a progressive growth of the industry, providing, of course, what our project needs, which is creating labor condition in East Africa. That is my presentation. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to respond. And if you want to see me after here too, I can give you my business card. If you are interested in seeing some kind of garment sectors like denim, wovens, knits, t-shirt, polos, whatever you need related to the apparel sector, we'll be happy to introduce you to those factories that are working in our base, in our home base office in Nairobi, Kenya. Thank you so much for your attention.
Great. Do you want to do a little Q&A? Do you have any questions for Andres, really quick? Anybody? Okay. Thank you, Andres.
Thank you.
Next, we have our Latin American Trade Commissioner panel.
It's just going to be an open discussion about to get more familiar with the South American market. And we have some trade representatives from various countries here. Guatemala, El Salvador, Peru, and Mexico. We'll be starting in about 12 minutes.